Hey, what's up, everybody? This is Ben. I have another session here of whiteboard talk, okay? Today's topic is why diets suck, underlined twice, all right? Why diets suck? So think of what a diet is. Diet is something that's been created to sell a book, pretty much. I understand that there's things out there to make you feel better, to heal certain things, to cut back on inflammation, when really it should just be an eating style. That's what we want you guys to focus on here. We want you guys to focus on what is it that's going to improve your relationship with food to make you better as an individual. So really thinking of diets, and I want to get into especially the last 100 years, and really thinking of, okay, in these last 100 years, man, what is it that has influenced us to the point of why we eat certain ways we eat? All right, so we're going to talk on a few things like World War I, the Great Depression, World War II. We're going to talk about, you know, big companies coming in, getting involved, and really helping you understand certain things behind why you do what you do. All right, so what we're going to talk about to kind of hit it off was World War I, World War II. And that's rationing. So everybody was told, you know, hey, we need strong soldiers. Do yourself a favor. Grow a garden. Cut back on the luxury items. You know, your fats, proteins, which is going to be meat, you know, butter. They wanted to send that off and to support the soldiers with that. The government did. So individuals, citizens, were asked upon to, hey, grow victory gardens. That's the patriotic thing to do, which was great from the sense of, you know, building up a nation through food, but at the same time, we took away some of the basic things. So things like, you know, if you're going to have pork, beef, those were luxury items. You know, it wasn't like you could have a steak every single meal or a burger every single meal. That was reserved for the soldiers. So rationing really cut back on, especially with women. It really kind of hit women hard from the standpoint of, okay, to do their service, they had to, you know, cut back on what they ate because the men needed it to be strong soldiers. So, which led into eating like a lady. Now, eating like a lady kind of is a big deal because, said women took that first step and they're like, all right, I'm doing this for the country. And then it became a trend. It was the cool thing to do. If you were slim and you ate like a rabbit, you were high society, man. You were really living the dream. So, using that theory of thinking, you know, food started kind of falling back into, if I eat less, the better off I am. Slim is sexy. Slim is cool, you know? So, that was a big issue. I'm going to talk about Betty Crocker. Now, what does Betty Crocker have anything to do with that? Well, General Mills hopped in. I'm sure you've heard of General Mills. They, you know, like, hey, crap. This sucks because the women who are doing most of the cooking, prepping food, are really cutting back on the food and really not doing what we need to support our bottom line. So what do? You know, they panic. Not necessarily panic. They all sat in a room, created something. They created Betty Crocker. I know you see her picture and all that stuff. And, oh, she's making brownies. Oh, whatever it is. Betty Crocker came to life. Now, Betty Crocker was there to support the food industry, so influencing people on, hey, sugar is good for you. White bread is good for you. These things you need, they're good for you. So, Betty Crocker came along, and that was a General Mills creation. The same time, Welch's popped up, and they're like, hey, we need to do the same thing, because I see it working for General Mills over there. So, Welch's came up with the same thing. They started saying that their products, the sugar in their products, helped you with energy. All right. So, the sugar that gave you the energy to do the things you needed to do to become a better person, help your family. That's a kind of interesting way to twist it, but that's what happened. So Betty Crocker, General Mills, Welch's and their products, sugar became a huge thing. White bread. So we talked about Betty Crocker's influence on white bread. So what white bread was, it was basically a sugary substance created to sell to women and their families. So what happened there is all of a sudden, especially in World War II, soldiers started becoming malnourished. I mean, they had a really, really high fail rate. I think it was, let's see, I can remember. You know what? I don't even remember what it is. I don't have it. It's in my notes somewhere. But there was a big, huge fail rate because everybody was so malnourished. It's everybody that was trying to be a soldier. So what happened after that? The government gets involved. The government gets involved and they say, guess what? We have crappy soldiers. Okay, so what we need to do is let's tell all the mills who are creating all this bread, because 98% of bread was white bread at that time, thanks to Betty Crocker and General Mills. So government says, hey, let's reinforce our bread, let's enrich it. All right, so that's the introduction of enriched foods, and really kind of started just for a soldier, and then it became a thing of, hey, we can get vitamins, hey, we can do these things through this. The government was really, really big involved in that. So also, another kind of interesting point is really tying back to the rationing. The government was really big into making sure meat prices stayed the same. You know, they didn't want to have this huge fallout with meat prices, especially when they're trying to provide food, protein especially, to their soldiers overseas. So what happened was the government says, hey, guess what? You know, we kind of need to say that there's a food, you know, protein meat shortage out there to make it, you know, keep that luxury item still going. So what they were doing, they were slaughtering millions and millions of animals. I mean, dumping their bodies, burning them, just to keep prices at a certain point, because if they drop, man, that's bad. We can't have that. So the government really got involved. So that's where meat wasn't a huge deal. It's still falling back onto eating like a lady, because women, if there's no meat, they can't eat a ton of it. They got to keep their waistlines in. So really, if you think about it, this whole thing, it feeds into this huge loop. I mean, it just keeps going and going and going. And so it's incredible to think that we've taken these certain things and we've really blown them up into really big deals. So kind of bottom line, what should you take from this? Is that there's always something behind when someone's telling you what to do when it comes to food. And that's why, you know, and books, I mean, if someone's telling you, hey, eat this, check this out, there's a book behind it. You know, and that's the crappy thing about it. How do you navigate through this whole thing if someone's just trying to sell you stuff? That's kind of what we're trying to do, is really break down and say, hey, guess what? You know what? Eating real food, no one's going to sell you a book on that, because at the same point, it's basic. It's so basic and so foundational, you can't write a huge book on it, although I could probably point you in the direction of a few of them. But understand that this huge thing, this huge cycle that's going around here like this, it's basically 100 years of people being forced to do certain things with food. Think about that, guys, and I hope, you know, maybe you learned something today. And I said, I'm going to come back to you guys next week with something even bigger. So, 100 years, man, Betty Crocker isn't real. Boom. See you guys.